Thank you all. I wasn't sure what to expect in the middle of the day with no alcohol. First thing I should do is apologize to Professor Holman, because he called up or emailed some time ago and said, can I have a title for what you're going to talk about? And I pulled one out of the air, grand sounding. I think it's on the page there. Was it Fiction, the High Road to Truth? And I was going to talk about that. I have all kinds of really, really important thoughts on that subject, and it has actually motivated me to get away from journalism a little bit a long time ago to write fiction and to tell stories that have large themes and ideas through the medium of fiction, which is something that's been going on for a very long time, and with some great effect by mediocre writers like Dickens and Steinbeck. So anyway, events of the past week kind of eclipsed what would otherwise have been an extremely important academic dissertation on truth, journalism, and literature. And I kind of got blown out of the water by events in Canada. You may expect that I'm going to talk about, and I don't know if you've ever heard this name, Gian Gomeshi, who Gian is a colleague at the CBC who got into a lot of trouble that we didn't really know very much about, resulting in the fact that he got fired on Sunday. And on Sunday night, he decided to jump out in front of the curve and tell us why he got fired, which was an extraordinarily explicit expose on his Facebook page about his sexual preferences, which he described as adventurous and consensual and bizarre, and gave rise to a national conversation which now treats as a proper noun a word that's not pronounceable as, but it sounds like BDSM. I don't know how many people here know what BDSM is. I didn't until I looked it up, but it has to do with bondage and discipline and domination and submission and masochism. All of this are part of his idea of a fun evening. And all his partners were fully consensual, and his problem with his employer, because some jilted girlfriend who decided after he jilted her that she didn't like it. Unfortunately for Jean, and he hired a major spin doctoring outfit to handle the fallout from this, and he launched a $55 million lawsuit against his former employer, and the whole country was saying, good on you. Well, in the last couple of days, 8 women have come forward to challenge his use of the word consensual, and they described being punched out, slapped, choked, humiliated, and completely blown away by this guy. And of course, as is frequently the case, too traumatized and too kind of skeptical about the way the world works to take this to the police and the proper authorities. And they just said, okay, it's just me, nobody's going to believe me anyway. And now they realize there were a lot of just me. So they're all coming out of the closet now, and they're saying, we had this experience with him. So that's an ongoing story in Canada. It doesn't really take us to any large theme or idea, so I'm just going to leave it there. If there are those of you with prurient interests who want to bring it up after the fact, I'll oblige. In the meantime, I'm going to talk a little bit about probably a more significant phenomenon of which we had a bit of an outcropping in Canada last week. I've worked, as Kim pointed out with great generosity, in broadcasting for 48 years. And my job was always up front, on the air, whether it was radio or TV. In the States, I would probably have become rich and famous. In Canada, I became prominent and not very rich. In the States, I'd be a star. In Canada, I'm just stared at quite a lot. Canadians are ambivalent about fame. As everywhere, Canadians are curious about famous people. But there's no widespread cultural worship of celebrity. And this might be changing, but it was the cultural reality that I grew up in. And at this point in my life, prominent is good enough for me. Even prominence can actually be a bit annoying, as when you're walking about your business on the street and some stranger comes up and says, "Hey, aren't you that guy on TV?" And ever since the publication of a book that achieved some notable success, if not notoriety, but it became well known in Canada, people are now coming up to me on the street and saying, "Hey, aren't you the guy who wrote that book?" And one day it happened to me early in the morning and I was feeling a bit un-Canadian, which translates as cranky. And a guy comes up and says, "Aren't you the guy who wrote that book?" And I snarled back, "What book?" He said, "You know the one." there is no response to that. In any case, prominence and modest financial success notwithstanding, I decided a few months ago to get out of TV altogether. As Kim points out, the word retired gets tossed around a lot, but you don't retire from the kind of work that I was doing. You do it until you don't do it anymore, and then you move on and you do something else that you hope will be as fulfilling and as rewarding in the long run. And I had always planned to continue doing what I was doing in broadcasting and journalism for as long as I had my marbles or until I dropped, whichever came first. Then a few months ago, I came to what we would probably call an epiphany moment, where I realized that to quit what I was doing just might be one of the most useful statements I've ever made in more than 50 years of practicing journalism. A little bit of background. I think most of you people are either Canadians or study Canada or at least are interested in it. And so you probably know what the CBC is. It's a public broadcaster in the British sense. And like the BBC, we are exempt legally from political interference. We are public service broadcasters, which is not the same as state broadcasters. We are accountable to the public through Parliament. A state broadcaster is accountable to the governing regime or tyrant. Politicians, even when they are guided by Parliament and legislation, they have a way of messing with even a public service institution like the CBC or the BBC because of the reality that in our case, the government controls the budget. And governments are always hostile when by law they have to give money to an institution, but they aren't allowed to tell the institution how to spend the money. So from the very outset of public broadcasting in Canada 78 years ago, politicians have been hostile to the CBC. And for the past quarter century, governments have kept the corporation in a form of palliative care. Which has meant the gradual withdrawal of the necessities of life, like money. Broadcasting is an expensive business, and the CBC legislated mandate is to provide services in both official languages and a number of Aboriginal dialects on two networks, on radio and television, and digital platforms, on one of the world's largest national territories. It's very expensive, and the upshot of shrinking budgets has been a serious cutback in programming and a loss of jobs in news and culture. And the losses are mostly being experienced by young people who happen to be the brightest, the most motivated, and the people who are most engaged with the technological and social and cultural challenges of our time. Old timers, and I have to count myself as one of them. I mean, it comes as a surprise even to me. But we have job security. Even when, as a cost-cutting measure, an old-timer's position is eliminated, it doesn't mean he or she will lose a job. People with seniority can bump a person with less seniority out of his or her position, even if the bumper isn't very good at the job he's bumping into, or if he even wants it very badly, he wants the income. So this has been going on at the CBC for quite some time. It becomes a Darwinian dog-eat-dog exercise, and the most vulnerable people are the people who are the most junior and who at the same time happen to be the people who have the greatest potential to keep the place alive over the long haul. I realized on reflection during the spring that while I have many skills that I acquired in the course of a long career, the one asset I don't have is potential, the potential to grow and to improve and to adapt to ever-changing circumstances. So I made a very simple recommendation to my bosses. I occupy one of four positions on the show I worked for. We're called hosts. Kill one of those positions. Kill my position. And that way you can probably protect the jobs of people who have more potential and less seniority. It wasn't the noble gesture that it sounds like. I was eligible for a pension, and I was getting kind of tired of television anyway. Not because I'm jaded, but just because I had for quite some time found the medium unsuitable for large, complex ideas that are essential to an understanding of the large, complex world we live in. And for the past 20 years or so, I've been getting a lot of satisfaction out of exploring complex ideas, and some of which I will get around to, in books, and especially in fiction. There was a surprising amount of public interest in what I did. It became a story. Now, I have mixed feelings about the fact that perhaps the greatest impact of anything I've done in journalism over 50 years was to quit. It sort of gave me a few paradoxically rewarding moments, but at the end of the day, I found out just how important the gesture was because it became apparent that a whole lot of people are worried about what I thought was exclusive to the troubled institution I worked at. It turns out, it seems, that everybody is worried for themselves, their parents, their friends, their sons or daughters about employment, career, job security, future prospects. I quickly learned the extent of public anxiety when I realized that we used to take for granted that every generation would, with a bit of good luck and half-good management, live better than the generations before. This is no longer realistic. And so my managers agreed that they would eliminate my position, and I left. And I believe two or three of my former colleagues are breathing easier, at least for now. My last day of work was September the 30th. Imagine my surprise when just 3 weeks later, last Wednesday, October the 22nd, I got an urgent email from my former executive producer. Would I consider coming back to help out for just a couple of days? There was a big story going down, and the show had only 48 hours to get it on the air in an hour-long format and provide some context for this story that was the whole world was going nuts about. And it was very hard to say no, and so I said yes. There had been two lethal attacks on Canadian soldiers in Canada in the space of a couple of days. And the show was hoping to hammer together a program that would provide context for the barrage of images and sentiments playing out moment by moment in the all-news cable realm. Because the incidents involved soldiers, and one of the incidents actually included an attack on Parliament, there were likely to be profound political consequences. Now, given the span of my career, it shouldn't be surprising that I have done a fair number of stories about violence, including terrorism. Violence is a very complex subject, and it's particularly important to understand it when people use violence to express dissent, or in a unilateral attempt to change the world, or some part of it, ultimately, the way the rest of us live. For quite a while, I've been troubled by the inability or the unwillingness, I'm not quite sure which it is, of the media, and TV in particular, to contribute much by way of understanding what terrorism really means. The word has become a political epithet, and it seems to justify any action in the cause of enhancing our security. So all behavior designated by politicians or cops as terrorism blends into a single paranoid impression. They're out to get us. They hate our freedom. They hate our prosperity, our lovely lifestyle, and they must be stopped by any means. The mass media have proven more effective at spreading and amplifying this unhelpful notion, often manufactured to serve political agendas, than in confronting the most important part of the famous media equation, the why. When there is a crisis, we put most of the emphasis on the who, the what, the where, and the when, all important details, but we avoid the why. The why takes too much time and brain power. It gets in the way of the news media imperative to be first and to have an impact and thereby get a larger audience and the advertising revenues that come with ears and eyeballs. In addition, the why can lead to tricky places because it requires analysis, and the inputs for the analysis will inevitably be less than scientific. Analysis of any unfolding story or breaking news will involve speculation. And speculation is, by nature, risky. What if we are wrong? What if we appear not to be infallibly prescient? What will people think? The fact is, there's nothing wrong with speculation when it's informed, balanced, and cautious, and acknowledges that we are journalists and not oracles. And we are always forgiven for honest imprecision, even errors, as long as we resist pretending that we are serving up the truth, which is a very tricky word in the best of circumstances. Even historians, after years of research and peer reviews, can fall short of truth. Priests and popes and politicians often fall short of truth. So people aren't going to lose their faith in journalism if some balanced speculation that made people think about the essential why might have been a little short of absolute revelation. But it's easier to play it safe. Focus on the drama, the sentiment, the superficial, the gory details. Heighten the excitement by sound effects and flashy graphics and loud delivery by attractive people whom we trust because they're familiar, which I suspected was one of the reasons my former boss wanted me to come back for a couple of days, because I am familiar and so terribly attractive. I remember the first time that I felt overwhelmed by an idea and by the why of a story that I was witnessing and trying to report on television. It was in late September, 1982, in Beirut, Lebanon. I happened to be in the region for a story about the Palestinian diaspora when I was dispatched to Beirut to cover a massacre that had just occurred in two adjacent refugee camps called Sabra and Shatila. It was over by the time I got there, but I was able to cover the gruesome aftermath. You can easily imagine the images, the stink, the flies, and the carnage. And I knew it would be bad when the taxi driver who delivered me and a cameraman through a back alleyway into the scene of this crime. And before we get out of the car, he opened his glove compartment and he handed us surgical masks. It was worse than I expected. But there was an image that for years afterwards I couldn't get out of my mind. It was a certain expression on the faces of a group of boys who were standing near me as we watched the recovery of a dead family from a little hut that had been blown up by the killers. The expression was one of cold, silent fury. And I remember thinking, this violence didn't start here, and it will not end here. This is part of a continuum, an epic tragedy. And then the despairing thought, how do I convey this subtlety in the context of all this graphic horror? That day, I learned, as best I could, the what, the how, the when. And I was able to give a general impression of the why. The massacre was by a Christian militia group backed up by the Israeli army. The victims were Palestinian civilians, women, kids, and old men. It was an act of revenge for atrocities by Palestinian fighters in a Christian village called Damour, south of Beirut, which had been an act of revenge for atrocities by Christian fighters in a refugee camp called Carantina, which had been an act of revenge for an act of revenge, etc. The scale of the Sabra Shatila massacre was huge. Nobody ever managed to complete a body count, but the estimates ranged all the way from 800 to more than 2,000. It would have been easy to believe that the outcome would be dramatic, maybe an end to the civil war that had been going on at that point for more than 7 years. Certainly, all parties would now step back, see the absurdity of what they were involved in. But of course they didn't. And the civil war went on for 18 more years, and one could make the case it isn't over yet. Unimaginable horror often produces optimism. World War I, the war to end all wars, the Holocaust, 9/11. Nothing like that could ever happen again. And we always hope that the optimists and the guardians of national security are right when they make that proclamation. Never again. But I suppose after years of experiencing the reality, I wouldn't bet on it. And here's why. The reality that I saw etched in the expressions on the faces of those boys at Sabra and Shatila. They would have known the dead people. Maybe they saw what happened. They were witnesses and survivors. And perhaps the most profound and lasting consequences of violence are the changes that occur in the hearts and minds of survivors. And so I did a little bit of research. How many people in that violent century, the 20th century, witnessed horrors such as the one those boys were part of just a few nights earlier? And it's a difficult figure to get your hands on. But I worked around it until I found an academic study that tells me the number of people killed by human design in the 20th century might have been as high as 231 million. 231 million people died by human design, which means that some individual or group had a design for their societies or the human race or maybe their own place in history. And 231 million people didn't fit. They were disposable and they were in the way of some political or military objective. In practical terms, their deaths removed them from the human project. They would not retaliate. They'd cause no trouble. But every single violent death left living witnesses, many of them loved ones, parents, children, siblings, and friends, who would live in grief and outrage and would be altered by it. Many of them driven mad by it, and they would take the madness everywhere they went for the remainder of their lives, and they would pass it on to their children and their children's children. And that's what hit me. Years after Sabra and Shatila, what I saw in the stern young faces of those boys, most of them not much more than 12 years old, a warning signal. The consequences of violence migrate in time and space and are felt in distant places throughout time. And given the violence of the 20th century, the legacy of outrage, it isn't hard to understand why so many bad things happen unexpectedly in the 21st millennium and in unlikely places like Canada, especially Canada. There's a complacency in Canada bordering on smugness that we are immune from the violence of our time. Canada is a country founded on the ideals of conciliation, compromise, and consensus. Canada came into being because of the recognition by two mortal enemies, the French and British nations, that they both faced two common existential threats in the land that they were fighting over: winter and her merciless accomplice, hunger. If these two superpowers couldn't learn to get along in this unforgiving place, they wouldn't last long, no matter who prevailed on the battlefield. Winter and hunger would make short work of them. And so they compromised on issues less important than survival. They reached a pragmatic consensus on language, religion, and political autonomy. And so we feel good about that, and how traditions based on compromise and common sense gave us a special role to play in world affairs. But times have changed. We, like many other places, have a new confrontational approach in government and politics, driven by an oppressive right-wing ideology. There are now millions of Canadians whose lives have been scarred, directly or indirectly, by violence. They are refugees and migrants from violent places. Canada, for 13 years, has been at war in Afghanistan, and we've recently signed on to a strange campaign of violence in Iraq and Syria. We have been and are part of a violent response to violence, and we can't expect not to be infected by the consequences. And so what was I to think last Wednesday when I got that urgent email from my former boss? He wants me back for a couple of days to help provide some context for what everyone was calling terrorist attacks. Two crazy guys killed two unsuspecting soldiers, one in a deliberate hit and run in a parking lot, one shot with an old hunting rifle as he stood on guard ceremonially at the National War Memorial in Ottawa. Now, I've had experience with covering violent conflict, including terrorism, and not just Sabra and Shatila. 20 years ago, I helped prepare an hour-long documentary called Seeds of Terror. I've done provocative, even speculative stories about the Bush wars in the Gulf in 91 and 03. I was part of a team that documented the radicalization of one of the 9/11 hijackers, Ziad Jarrah, who until a couple of years before September the 11th, 2001, had been a drinking, dancing, easygoing party animal. I was part of a major examination of Islamist violence in Europe by the CBC and PBS Frontline, the bombings in Madrid and London, and the phenomenon called homegrown terror. I guess that's really why they wanted me to come back, for a couple of days anyway. But it was also why I had misgivings. So I wrote a memo to the boss and to my former colleagues, and it, in part it said this: my takeaway from what we've done in the past is to demonstrate that the problem is political fanaticism that in specific cases turns into criminal insanity. It's always been a factor throughout history. The tragedy for Islam is that there isn't anything theological about the modern phenomenon. It's reactionary, a response to psychotic feelings of exclusion among people who are probably excluded because they're unbalanced and extreme by nature. People who grab onto Salafist and Takfiri doctrines, as I think we've shown, reject modernity in all its manifestations but one: the technology of communication. The internet, the mobile phones, the social media. These aspects of modernity, arguably at the root of modern alienation and superficiality, amplify their voices and create bonds and common cause with other social misfits. And given modern mobility and the means to create violence, whether by a single high-powered rifle or a dirty bomb or a hijacked airplane, they have unprecedented reach and power. So I think the big problem is with leadership that, instead of telling us to be calm, to keep a rational perspective, want us to be terrified, because when people are afraid, they tend to do what they're told. And I wish there was some way that the takeaway from our piece will be that this, folks, was not the beginning of an insurrection, but a crime that has become more common, but still an act of deviant behavior by a misfit. I got no response. But I shrugged anyway, and I rolled up my sleeves, and I went back to work, and I should point out, as a volunteer, with no great expectations of what we would be able to add to the story in 48 hours. In the end, I was glad that I had agreed to help. I think we rose above the noisy chatter of over-caffeinated reporters and instant analysts by taking a closer look at the perpetrators, two clearly deranged individuals, one of whom had been crying out for help for months, a crack addict who was trying to get in jail so that he could clean up. And we made the point that the violence we call terrorism is a kind of invasive weed with roots deep in the soil of history, and that modern technology creates the alarming possibility that these roots can now link up and spread unpredictably, compromising vulnerable minds, and that there is a predictable continuum from disillusionment to alienation to piety to fanaticism to murder. Of course, I'm saying it a lot better now, succinctly and without a lot of bells and whistles, but and I also don't have lawyers and editors and language police hovering over me, but that's the gist of it. We were trying to say, step back, take a deep breath, think. Unfortunately, I think our cautionary message will be lost because we are facing two insuperable realities each time we are faced with what we now impulsively call terrorism. The first is that people tend not to want to do a lot of thinking in a crisis. We want information, and we want reassurance that we are safe, and that this is a particular situation that can be attributed to an evil individual or group, and that the situation is under control, and it is exceptional. The second is a bit more complex, and it's a pure speculation on my part, so I've never got to spell it out before in public. But this is a university, a place for innovative thought. So here goes. I came to the opinion, I won't call it a conclusion, but a viable opinion in the months after 9/11, that while that project was without a doubt a terrorist attack in every sense, it revealed something terribly disturbing about public vulnerability. I began to suspect in the aftermath of 9/11 the new laws and the security establishment, the orange and red alerts, the intolerable paranoia in airports and other public places, that the other side of the coin of terrorism is a sinister reality called fearism. Fearism is an impulse to take political and commercial advantage of the circumstances created by an act of terrorism. Public confusion, volatile feelings of vulnerability, systemic fear. To consolidate that in that moment, to consolidate political and economic power, to advance an ideological thought becomes hard to resist. I don't think it's unduly speculative to suggest that when people are afraid, they are inclined to suspend the admirable quality of skepticism. We are inclined to do what our leaders tell us to do in times of peril. People in positions of leadership take on almost infallible qualities in a time of crisis. Anybody with a headset or a t-shirt, a traffic pylon, a badge or gun or title becomes a figure of authority. And in a crisis, we are inclined to do what we are told to do by people in authority. For politicians in a democracy, it's awfully tempting to take advantage of this momentary suspension of our critical faculties, our instinct to become followers and to accept restrictions on our freedom in the name of freedom, our willingness to buy into propositions that would be absurd and intolerable at any other time. And the mass media play into this, it troubles me to say, because we become unwitting conduits for the fear that spreads among us. We become political facilitators, transforming rational and conscientious individuals into reactionary units in a frightened biomass. Given that, in the heat of the moment, people are screaming for information, even if it's just fantasy or gossip, the media will struggle to oblige and to make a lot of advertising money in the process. And people in positions of authority will look back with great nostalgia on a time when leadership was easy because people willingly accepted a suspension of their rights. This is pretty normal. In times of war, we necessarily accept the intolerable on a temporary basis. Conscription, censorship, rationing, emotional manipulation through systemic propaganda. All sorts of stuff that would make Hobbes and Orwell grin and nod their heads in their respective graveyards. But this normal phenomenon becomes an enduring problem when we allow the imperatives of crisis to become embedded in our minds and in our laws. Historically, as a crisis wanes, we seem to regain our senses and perspective. Human history is full of terror and repression. And in spite of it, sometimes because of it, the continuation of enlightenment and progress. But we should be concerned by some of the thinking now in influential places, where there seems to be an unwillingness to be informed by confidence in history and human nature. We should be very careful that the seeds of terror planted in a violent century don't blossom in the future as tentacles of tyranny, and that tyranny strangles rights and freedoms we've spent centuries achieving. History offers much to cultivate despair, but also inspiration. And I've often, in the course of my career as a reporter, a career that has exposed me to a lot of conflict, violence, and sometimes terror, been inspired by a line from the great American politician Franklin Roosevelt. Everybody knows the line. It's from Roosevelt's first inaugural address in 1933. But it's one of those simple insights, always worth remembering and repeating. The only thing we have to fear is fear itself, nameless, unreasoning, unjustified terror. And I would add that the best antidote for fear, the only antidote, in fact, is reason. Thank you. So if you want to talk about Gian Gomeshi,
Kim, you're excluded.
Thank you.
No, I don't want any. Are you sure that Zainab X is better than Katie?
I was there for 3 years. We never lost a football. And Acadia never even came close.
Those are the old days.
Those are the old days. Now, it might have improved since then.
Yes.
Okay. And academically,
you know what that
who
actually
who cares when you're 21 years old?
You know what that means?
What's
denied
that?
Acadia.
What does it mean?
Never heard of that one before.
Denied Acadia.
Yes.
Thank you so much for such a rich talk. I really appreciate it. I lived on the border for a while, so I was a great fan of CBC. But I was curious, I don't know if you've heard, but I've been quite taken lately with Johann Galtung's ideas about the connections between structural, direct, and cultural violence. Do you know, and he talks about cultural violence sort of legitimating the other types of violence. And I just wonder with what you said, I mean, it sounds like you're in such a tough place in the media because you don't want to legitimate that type of violence, but you're sort of caught in sort of offering that. So that way that they interweave, you know, together.
Well, one of the frustrations is that people don't really think that deeply in the media when you're faced with violence. And I think that this is what, you know, a Canadian politician, the leader of the Liberal Party, Justin Trudeau, made a remark, I think it was after the Boston Marathon bombing, after some incident here, that we have to look at root causes. And the poor fellow, I don't think he realized what a lightning rod that phrase is, root causes. When you start talking about root causes, you are moving to exculpate the perpetrators. And so I guess in the analysis of what motivates people to do these things, cultural, physical, political, it sort of gets, it's something forensic. It's a subject for an exercise that very rarely happens because most of the people that do these things end up dead. And it's one of the reasons I regret the death penalty. I'll be very clear, you know, about that. I regret the death penalty, not because I feel squishy about people who kill people, but because I believe that we shouldn't be so concerned about the fact that people who do evil things are evil, but we should be more interested in finding out why they do evil things. And the minute you define somebody as evil and forget about the thing and the moral quality of the thing, it becomes very simple. Well, get rid of the evil person. And then, of course, once you get rid of the evil person, you've lost your opportunity to dig down through that person's psyche and find out why they did the evil thing, which is what really matters. I mean, everybody's got capacity to do evil things. Everybody's got the capacity to do very good things. Even evil people have a capacity to do good things. I spent a day on death row with a guy who died 6 o'clock that evening, and we talked all, you know, well, I didn't spend the whole day, I spent 3 hours, and we talked about all this stuff. And I came away saying, this guy's being executed for doing an extremely evil thing. He stuck a butcher knife in the heart of an old widow who lived by herself because they thought she had money hidden in the house. Now, you don't, I guess you can get more evil, but that is about as evil as I want to think about. And I sat there, I talked to this guy for 3 hours, and he talked about it with great remorse, not because he was going to die that evening. He was totally accepting of that. He was from Alberta. He says, I grew up with a redneck. He says, I believe you commit the crime, you do the time, and you pay the penalty, and I'm going happily at 6 o'clock this evening. That was his attitude, and he did not waver. It's easy to have bravado when it's kind of an abstraction, but when you're going to die in a few hours, I took it. So I said to myself, maybe nobody is evil. Maybe it doesn't matter. Maybe the only thing that matters is the evil deed. And so you get back to your question, you know, like, where does this stuff come from? Does it come from cultural influences? Does it come from history? We got to find that out. And we got to start finding that out by keeping people who do bad things alive long enough to tell us what they were thinking, if anything.
I too enjoyed your talk. I was thinking about what you said about getting to the human and what is really going on there. And I was struck by the parallel between your notion of fearism and the way that we think of crime. So the way we think of crime is rooted in this notion of fear. And so we over-enforce, we incarcerate, but there's a very specific way that we incarcerate. You know, we incarcerate specific races, we incarcerate specific classes. And I wonder if when we think about terrorism, so much of this is a lack of understanding of culture and a race-based fear. And I wonder what your thoughts are on that and how we get to an exposition or a conversation about that in just a different frame.
Yeah, I wouldn't feel quite as miserable as a human being about Guantanamo Bay, for example. If instead of it being a sort of a quasi-punishment a medium for a bunch of people, many of whom didn't belong there, it had become a kind of a workshop. First of all, who are the bad people here, and send the rest of them home, for God's sakes. Instead of treating them all as equally bad, and to be contained, and not to be understood, but to be used as conduits for more information about more bad people that you can take out. And it's okay to use them as sources of information about other people who are going to do bad things. But at the same time, I thought it was sort of a useful opportunity to sort of dig down into their psyches and their problems. And so I'm wandering off of the question, but I guess the point is that incarceration, as it is practiced throughout the Western world, is arguably an improvement over Iran and China, where you have to pay for the bullet that they shoot into the back of your head, apparently. But it is a hugely, it is in many cases warehousing. It is a waste of human potential, and it is a wasted opportunity to find out what makes people tick. People and I've been probably in more correctional facilities than I ever thought I would see across Canada and the U.S. And I'm always struck when I deal with inmates. They're not stupid people in most cases. Some of them are really off the rails. But they tend to be in the mess they're in, either because of horrifying social deprivation, or because they're smarter than the average bear. And they have a kind of a disdain for people who get up and wash their face and brush their teeth and go to work and earn their way. That's for losers. So we'll get a better way of doing it. So those are the two largest groups. And in the one group, you gotta rehabilitate those. And in the other group, you gotta teach them, you know what? There is a smarter way. If you're so smart, what are you doing in here? What are you doing in here for 10 years? If you're so smart, well, you don't know all the stuff I got away with. That doesn't matter. You're in here now, and you aren't getting out until that guy says you can. And he's going to treat you like a dog for all the time you're here. Is that smart? Is that a product of smartness? So I believe in the whole system of corrections and incarceration and justice and law and order, this whole emphasis on the moral quality of the individual and the constraint of people with an evil quality by coercion and incarceration and violence in a way that completely overlooks root causes, socioeconomic circumstances, mental health issues. The guy that was executed in Texas, the fellow I spent the day with, had fallen out of a moving vehicle at the age of 11, landed on his head, and his whole family and friends, it never came up in the trial, it never came up in the appeals, but it came up in a conversation with members of his family when all hope was lost, that he had gone from this easygoing, pleasant, chattery little boy to this sullen, dark kid in the space of time it took to recover from that accident. And he kept everything under control. He got married, he had a family. But the minute he took a glass of beer or alcohol or a drug, he went nuts and ended up on death row in Texas. Now, he's gone. He didn't care whether he was going or not. I care because we should have factored some of that into the judgment that we made. And we didn't. And there are an awful lot of people in those places from whom we can learn a great deal by not necessarily sympathy, but empathy, and curiosity, and self-interest.
So it sounds like you have this real quest to find out the why for violence and terrorism, and I'm curious, is that what, was it this frustration that you experienced that drove you to write fiction, and where you could be more free, I guess, to explore?
That seminal moment, you know, I watched that day and they took out bloated bodies of mothers and I was standing there with a horrifying moment that was so small in the larger context. If they were using a front end loader to lift the rubble away and then they'd stop and they'd scrape and they'd drag somebody else out. At one point I'm standing there and my cameraman is beside me and the bucket of the front end loader goes up and this thing goes plop by my foot. And I look down and it's an infant's arm from the elbow of a little hand, right? A couple of guys rushed over with a stretcher. They put the stretcher down and they picked that thing up and put it on the stretcher and carried it off. And I said to myself, what will they think tonight? And the little boys who are looking at that, who may have known that kid, that toddler, what are they thinking? That's when I spotted in those faces that frozen, furious, frightening expression. And it never left me. So I started thinking about people in my own life. I grew up in a village about as far from that stuff. Nothing ever happened. Nothing exciting, nothing violent, nothing. Maybe a couple of people were getting a fist fight over alcohol or something. But I remember there was one war veteran, he lived up the hill from me, and I can remember coming home from school one day, and I could see him up at his fence line, and he had his hunting rifle, and it was propped on the fence post, and it was generally pointing in my direction. I didn't know, what is he doing? And then I looked, and between him and me was a dead dog. He just willy-nilly picked off a dog. And I said, what was John doing? And they said, oh, he's been drinking. John had been shot through the head in World War II, and he was fine until he started to drink, and then he started to shoot the place up. And then I started to say to myself, maybe that's why his kids are such a mess, living with that. And then I started thinking, there's an act of, they probably don't even know how he got shot between the eyes and survived it. all they know is what he's like. If you ask around, oh, you should have known him before he went away to the war. He was the sweetest guy in the village. When he came back from the war, this zombie who got married and had kids. And then you start to feel sorry for the kids. And then you, you know, I've lived long enough, now the kids have kids. And those kids are kind of messed. And then you hear it all the time. We now call and talk about PTSD. We talk about all the psychological damage done in war. Back in those days, it was called shell shock. He's got shell shock, and there's nothing you can do about it. Well, now we're sort of thinking a bit more creatively about the psychological and emotional damage done by violence. So I came away from, and it suddenly crystallized, not by looking at dead bodies. You know, you have filters that screen out the nausea and the horror of looking at a dead body. But when I look at the expression of loathing directed at me in the face of a young person who's going to live longer and be stronger than I am, now that is the takeaway from the moment. And then I got real interested, for a very selfish reason, why do bad things happen? When you look at the history of the 20th century, I'm surprised there are more bad things happening. It's almost an assertion that there's something in human nature that rises above the inclination to act out of revenge and hatred. And that gives me a little bit of hope. So I'm not so surprised that a bunch of guys, you know, when I did the follow-up on 9/11 and I went to Lebanon and I went to Germany and I went to Florida following the trail of this Lebanese hijacker, I was just astounded. As a matter of fact, we were spending so much money, we thought we were all going to lose our jobs, because by the time we got to Hamburg, Germany, this guy wasn't a hijacker. This was a guy who grew up totally secular, in a secular family in Lebanon, went Catholic school, educated in French, girlfriends, booze, friends on the street. Oh, that guy didn't have a shred of religion in him. Why would he kill himself in the name of a religious fanatical movement? So we get to Germany, our story is going to be that Zia Jarrah was innocent. But when we hung around Hamburg for a while, we started to pick up little things. Something transformed in there. And it starts with feeling alienated and feeling kind of homesick, going to the mosque, getting in with some friends, getting invited to prayer gatherings and political discussion in a suburb of Hamburg, disappearing for weekends. Little prayer mat appears in the corner of his room. He starts to wear long clothes and grow whiskers. His girlfriend starts to complain. She's a Turkish secular woman. She starts to complain to a mutual friend of theirs that he's putting heat on her to dress properly and to, you know, change her life. And suddenly you begin, something happens. And then we look, where was he going in Harburg? Well, he happened to be going to a place that was frequented by a fellow named Mohammed Atta, who had gathered a little group of religious people around him. And next thing, we're in Florida, and they're all learning how to fly airplanes, not to take off or land, but to keep them in the air long enough to do whatever it is they have in mind. So there is a, you know, just by virtue of the journey we made, we learned a lot about this Ziad Jarrah fella, and probably would have been more difficult to learn about al-Shahi and Atta and all the rest of them, because they were from Yemen and Saudi Arabia, places that aren't particularly friendly to journalistic inquiry. But Lebanon was pretty open, so we wandered around Lebanon as much as we had to. And so, once again, you ask the questions. You say, where did he make the turn, and why did he make the turn? And what if some other influence had been present? History would have been different. If this guy, instead of getting exclusively involved with a crowd of people led by that crazy Mohammed Atta, had sort of moved to a slightly less extreme prayer group, you know, the world would be quite a different place. I wouldn't have to take my shoes off in the airport. So it's a matter of taking the toxicity out of phrases like root causes and allowing ourselves to be curious, allowing ourselves to ask questions and to treat people who do evil things as just people who have done evil things, as opposed to demons who need to be exterminated.
I was just thinking of ISIS when you were talking, and how you hear that the technology that people are joining from the United States and Europe and wanting to go and become so violent. And everyone's, even the terrorists, are afraid of the ISIS.
Yeah, and then for good reason. You know, on ISIS, I'm a kind of a hardliner. I don't consider them to be terrorists, or I don't consider them to be political. That's a gang of criminals. There's 20,000 of them. You can't quantify the number of people who are Al Qaeda. You can't quantify the number of people who are motivated by the Salafist ideology. This is 20,000 really violent people. And I believe the only way to deal with them is by putting the boots on the ground and sort of helping the Kurds and helping out just in a ground level showdown. And I think at the end of the day, we have to know where they're coming from. They're coming from self-interest, they're coming from weak-minded inclination to follow a guy who wants to roll time back to the 15th or 14th century. But behind all that, there's a quest to have a territorial integrity that they can exploit and get rich. It is a very advanced and sophisticated form of piracy. And they dress it all up as some sort of religious mission. You know, God bless the Somalis who hijack oil tankers. They're not pretending to be anything more than hijackers of oil tankers. And they want money. They want ransom. Come on. But this crowd, you know, they dress it up as some kind of a divinely inspired mission when it's nothing more or less than a quest for political and economic power. And there's enough weak-minded followers around the world to jump in there and deal with it. So they're exceptional to the general rule of things, I believe, and we're handling them all wrong. We're sending a whole bunch of half-armed Kurdish Peshmerga in to fight these fellas, and we're up there dropping bombs down, hoping they hit the right targets. And every time they hit a wrong target, ISIS gets more support. I'd support ISIS if a bomb dropped down and killed my parents or my kids or my friends.
I've heard from many of my elders that they believe that war and terrorism is becoming a technological aspect of it, like a large aspect of it is technology and social media and a way of communicating faster. And my elders think that ISIS is a sort of technological warfare, how they have all these followers, that all these people, I just wanted to know like your opinions.
No, that's absolutely true. They've mastered the art of communication. They know how to completely horrify people. And they know how to, on the other hand, they've got this Brit that they've turned into their correspondent who shows up on TV reporting on their thoughts and what their interests are. I'm sure the guy's probably going to be killed when they're through with it. But at the same time, they've got highly sophisticated messages going out around the world to recruit ordinary young people who are disaffected, who are just maybe they want to be engaged with something that's has a bit more existential relevance than the newest iPad. The young people are always, throughout time, looking for ideals that they can feel strongly about and that can give meaning to their lives. Once upon a time, your parents gave it to you with a with a firm hand, and the church gave it to you. And nowadays, there isn't so much of that. So young people are saying, well, you know, there's got to be more than this. And somebody comes along and says, somebody with a particular interpretation of Islam comes along and says, well, read this. You've got an ideology here that's political, that's social, religious. It's all about justice. It's all about eternal eternity becomes tempting to somebody who's really looking for, you know, a meaning. We used to embrace jazz. We used to, you know, we used to dress with black clothes, go long hair. Now it's got to be more than that. Anyway, thank you.
Thank you.